here, I still have 2 hours to preach.
Yeah, amen. Praise God.
Well, time flies when you're having fun. Right?
Amen.
But we're finishing up today, or moving on with Jacob part two. We looked at Jacob and Esau last week, and we're going to deal with Jacob specifically. What's very interesting about Jacob and his life and his call from God is that Jacob had a tendency to do things his way. And his mother seemed to lead him in that sometimes, doing it his way instead of God's way. Now, of course, none of us have those kind of problems.
Amen.
The Lord says something to us, boy, we get right with it, right? Yeah. But Jacob had a problem, and we dealt with that last week. And so we sort of left off last week with Jacob having to leave the area. I'm going to sort of pick it up at chapter 27, verses 41 through 45. So Esau bore a grudge against Jacob because of the blessings with which his father had blessed him. And Esau said to himself, "The days of mourning for my father are near. Then I will kill my brother Jacob." By the way, what's really interesting, Esau talks about his revenge that he wants to get against Jacob. And he says that the days of mourning for my father are near. His father didn't die until over 20 years later. The old man hung on for a long time. In verse 42, it says, "Now when the words of her elder son Esau were reported to her, Rebekah, she sent and called her younger son Jacob and said to him, 'Behold, your brother Esau is consoling himself concerning you by planning to kill you.'" Now, Esau was the older son. Jacob was the younger son. By how much? Maybe 30 seconds, because they were twins and born right after one another. And remember that when Esau was born, Jacob had a hold of his heel and was pulled out with him. And he was named Jacob, which means the supplanter. Now going on in verse 43, Rebekah instructs his son, "Now therefore, my son, obey my voice. Arise and flee to Haran, to my brother Laban, and stay with him a few days until your brother's fury subsides." Now, Jacob ends up staying 20 years. His mom wanted him to just go for a few days, but he was there for 20 years, and you'll see why. So Jacob does leave, and if you look at chapter 28, verses 1 through 4, "So Isaac called Jacob and blessed him and charged him and said to him, 'You shall not take a wife from among the daughters of Canaan.'" One of the things that was clear when Abraham and his family and his people crossed the Euphrates into the promised land, that frankly, Abraham knew nothing about. He was just obeying God, just following God's direction. But it was always a known factor that Abraham was not allow his descendants to marry the Canaanites because they were idol worshippers. And so Isaac reiterates this in this verse. You shall not take a wife from among the daughters of Canaan. Arise, go to Paddan Aram and the house of Bethel, your mother's father, and from there take yourself a wife from the daughters of Laban, your mother's brother. And you may, and may God Almighty bless you and make you fruitful and multiply you that you may become a company of peoples. May he also, listen to this, may he also give you the blessings of Abraham to you, to your descendants with you, and you may possess the land of your sojournings which God gave Abraham. Notice that with Abraham, it was passed on to Isaac. Isaac passed it on to Jacob. The blessings of God and the anointing of God and the purpose of God came through, and the promise of God through the descendants of Abraham. Now, I would like to think I know that each one of us who are believers would like to think that about our family and those that come after us. But we look around at some of our families that's with us today, and we wonder, you know, there may be some problems from time to time. And there are. Not everybody willingly jumps on the bandwagon to serve, obey, and follow God, do they?
Amen.
Even though mom and dad did, even though grandma and grandpa did, there are sometimes children and grandchildren, nieces and nephews, who do not, who choose not to follow the Lord. Or sometimes not until much later in life, when a lot of damage has already been done. And that's sad and really too bad. I was thinking, and in fact, Jonathan and I were just talking the other day about Franklin Graham. Now, I don't know if you remember when Franklin Graham was a young man. He was not a believer. And he was a concern and a worry to his father, Billy. And Billy prayed for him, prayed that God would get Franklin and bring him home and bring him to the Lord. Thank God he did. And I want to tell you something. No matter how far afield some of our children get, some of our grandkids go, never give up on them. It's one of the reasons that Winston Churchill has always been a hero of mine. By the way, I heard a very interesting story about him. Because, you know, when Billy Graham died a few weeks ago, a lot of things were coming out about his life and people that he had known and people that he witnessed to and everything. And in his first visit to England and his crusade that he had over there, Winston Churchill and most of Parliament and most of the aristocrats there would have nothing to do with Billy. They thought that he was just there to cause trouble. But after a while, they realized that it wasn't, that it was a revival taking place. Towards the end of the revival, Winston Churchill, who had chosen not to talk to Billy or even meet him in prior to this, sent word to Billy Graham and said, I would like to meet with you at number 10 Downing Street. Who knows what number 10 Downing Street is? It's where the Prime Minister of England. And so Billy went, and they met together privately. Well, it only came out after Winston Churchill passed away that Winston had told Billy that you are not to divulge anything about our meeting. That it's private, and I do not want my words spread about. But Billy Graham prayed with him. I'm hoping that Winston Churchill received Christ.
Amen.
I don't know. But one of the reasons that Winston Churchill has always been a hero of mine, he made a speech one time to a graduating class, and he says, never give up. Never give up. Never give up. Never give up. And I think we need to be that way about our children, about our grandchildren, about our nieces, our nephews, our friends that we worry so about, that perhaps have not become Christians, who perhaps have chosen to ignore the things of God and who have chosen to go their own way, which is usually the wrong way. But we need never to give up on them, to continue to pray for them, to continue to not lose heart, but to know that God has a plan for each of us if we will only say yes to Him. Jacob was such a young man. Jacob was a deceiver and a liar. He lied to his father and deceived his father and tricked his father into giving him the blessing and passing on the blessing to him instead of his brother Esau. You know the story. Now you would think, well, that's easy to solve. Tell Jacob he was a bad boy and get Esau in here and pray for him. But this was different. God passed his blessing through the laying on of hands from Abraham to Isaac. And Isaac passed it on to Jacob. And it was done. You know, there are some things in life, it's just done and there's no changing it. And this is what happened with Jacob. I believe in my heart all along that God had a plan for Jacob to lead the house of Israel. Now, I'd like for you to look, I just wanted to remind you also in chapter 28 about the ladder into heaven. Remember, we talked about this last week, and about how as Jacob left and headed for his uncle's house, that he stopped to sleep for the night, and there had a dream and saw angels going and coming into heaven. And there God spoke to him. And in chapter 28, verse 12, and Jacob, women, I'm getting messed up again. Help me out here.
Verse 11 and 12.
Oh, it is verse 15. Okay. Chapter 28, verse 15. I'm not going to read all of it, but just this part. And behold, I am with you and will keep you wherever you go and will bring you back to this land, for I will not leave you until I have done what I have promised you. God was reassuring Jacob. Even though the way you went about this was not the right way, even though now you have been turned away from your father's house and are going into a strange land, I want you to know, I am with you. I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. And you know, many times in our lives we need that reassurance. I'll never forget when I went overseas, when I was in the army. I was 19 years old. And I remember stepping off of that plane at the airport at Kimpo base, scared to death, not knowing where it was going to take me, what was going to happen. And there was a chaplain handing out Gideon testaments to us all. And I was reminded, it doesn't matter where I go, God is with me, as though I were in my mother and dad's living room. It's okay. And you know, we need that reassurance.
Amen.
We face some things in life, and some things that we're unsure of, and things that would cause an ordinary person that didn't know Jesus to lose heart. But we need not ever lose heart, for God is with us. His Holy Spirit is within us. And if we've given our heart to Jesus, we have nothing to fear or nothing to worry about. And Jacob was reminded of that promise. Now in chapter 29, look what happens in verse 1. Then Jacob went on his journey. Oh, by the way, he named that place Bethel. Bethel, that's going to come up later. Then Jacob went on his journey and came to the land of the sons of the east. And he looked and saw a well in the field. And behold, three flocks of sheep were lying there beside it. For from that well they watered the flocks. Now the stone on the mouth of the well was large. When all the flocks were gathered there, they would then roll the stone from the mouth of the well and water the sheep, and put the stone back in its place on the mouth of the well. And Jacob said to them, my brothers, where are you from? And they said, we are from Haran. And he said to them, do you know Laban, the son of Nahor? And they said, we know him. And he said to them, it is well with him? And they said, it is well. And behold, Rachel, his daughter, is coming with the sheep. And he said, behold, it is still high day. Is it not time for the livestock to be gathered, water the sheep, and go pasture them? But they said, we cannot until the flocks are gathered. And they rolled the stone from the mouth of the well. Then we watered the sheep. While he was still speaking with them, Rachel came with her father's sheep, for she was a shepherdess. Now, already, we learned something about this woman, Rachel. She was different than most of the women of her day. She was a shepherdess. That was a little odd. Mostly the women stayed indoors because they didn't want to get sunburned. They didn't want their skin to be burnt, and they liked to get in the house. Rachel was not such a woman. She was a shepherdess. She wanted to be outside, and she took care of her sheep. And verse 9, while he was still speaking, no, verse 10, and it came about when Jacob saw Rachel, the daughter of Laban, his mother's brother, and the sheep of Laban, his mother's brother, that Jacob went up and rolled the stone from the mouth of the well and watered the flock of Laban and his mother's brother. And then Jacob kissed Rachel and lifted his voice and wept. And Jacob told Rachel that he was a relative and his father, and that he was Rebekah's son, and she ran and told her father. Now I want you to know something. This wasn't, he saw Rachel, ooh la la, and grabbed her and kissed her. This was something they did in those days. When a family member came and you hadn't seen them or ever met them or whatever, they would give you a kiss. And you're going to find out as you read this that even when he saw Laban, Laban grabbed him and gave him a kiss. So he was kissing Rachel as a family member. I'm so glad to meet you. But, by the way, they did fall in love. And they had quite a love story. We don't have time to get into all of that this morning, although I do still have an hour and a half left. But anyway, it goes on then. So it came about when Laban heard the news of Jacob, his sister's son, that he ran to meet him and embraced him and kissed him and brought him to the house. Then he related to Laban all these things. And Laban said to him, surely you are bone of my flesh. And he stayed with him a month. Then Laban said to Jacob, because you are my relative, should you therefore serve me for nothing? Tell me, what shall your wages be? Now, I'm going to sort of tell the story a little bit now about what happened because we don't have time to do it all. But Laban had two daughters. One's name was Leah, and one's name was Rachel. Of course, we already know who Jacob liked. And so he takes this opportunity with Laban. He says, I'll tell you what, I'd really like to marry and have as a wife Rachel. I'm willing to work for you 7 years to have her as my wife. And so they agreed. Now the problem was that Rachel was the second born, and it was customary in those days for the firstborn to be married first, and then the next, and then the next. But apparently, according to scripture, Leah didn't have the same pizzazz that Rachel had, and he wanted Rachel. So anyway, he agreed to work 7 years for Rachel. Now, folks, men, would you have worked 7 years for your wife? I remember when I met Sandy. In fact, I got to tell you a funny story. I first came to this church the first time in December of 1995. Sandy and I had just met and had just started dating. We had no idea that we were headed for marriage or anything like that. But the first Sunday I came, she came with me. And, you know, everybody got to know her. Well, come about Valentine's Day, which was just a little bit later, I'd already been called as pastor. She says, when are we going to get married? Now, she'll tell a different story. Anyway, we began to think about getting married. And so I came to the church council of this church. And I called for a church council meeting with the deacons of this church. And I asked them for permission to marry Sandy. And I said, if you choose, if you don't think I should, if this isn't good, then I'll go by what you say because I believe in the church and the way God leads the church. And so you remember Jim Smith? He said, don't worry about it, Pastor. Just don't come this next Wednesday night. We're going to have a business meeting to make this decision. So I didn't come. Jim Smith called a special business meeting, and they voted on whether or not Sandy and I could get married. And the church voted unanimously that we could get married, and we were married the following May. So it's your fault. But I really put myself in that position because I so much wanted God's will to be done. Anyway, at this point, I don't think Jacob was really thinking about seeking God's will. Sometimes we get out in the world and the wind sort of blows us from the left and to the right and wherever we happen to go. And if this feels good or this looks good or this seems to have promise, well, okay, let's do this. Or, well, okay, let's do that. Christian believers, they need to pray about every decision they make. We need to pray and seek God's guidance in everything that we do. That way we don't end up having to go back and make repairs that we never needed to make. And we've all made mistakes, haven't we? I wish I could say that in my life I had prayed about everything. I didn't. I'm sure if you were to be honest about it too, there are some things in your life that you didn't pray about either. But that's not the point. As believers, we are always learning and growing and seeking to be more like Christ and more into the obedience of God. And Jacob was on a learning curve with God. He'd started off badly. He'd started off in deceit and lies. God takes him to his uncle's, and there he meets his wife, but he makes him wait 7 years. Well, at the end of 7 years, guess what happened? They had this big wedding. It was customary in those days that you didn't see your bride till afterwards. So he goes in the tent, and he spends the night with this woman that was not Rachel. It was Leah, because her dad made the decision that she needed to be married first. He comes up and says, wait a minute! This isn't what I had worked for 7 years. He says, well, you can work another 7 years for Rachel if you want. So he did. He worked another 7 years. And so he worked 7 years for Leah, who he didn't want, and 7 years for Rachel, that he really wanted. So technically, he waited 14 years for this woman. He must have really loved her.
Amen.
Ladies, wouldn't you love to have a man that loved you that much? I didn't hear much noise out there. Now, here's the interesting thing that happened with Jacob. And I know I'm going rather quickly, but I want to get to a point because Jacob is the major turning point in what God does with Israel. In fact, God changes Jacob's name to Israel. And all of the people, you've heard the term the children of Israel, that's really the children of Jacob. So Jacob not only got two wives, but each of them had a handmaid. And so now he has two wives and two concubines. And then the 20 years that he was with Laban, he had 13 children, 12 boys, and a girl named Dinah. All of these sons, some were born of Leah, some were born of her handmaid, some were born of Rachel, some were born of her handmaid. Now Rachel had trouble with childbearing. And in her last, her last child was Benjamin. And the two youngest children were Joseph and Benjamin. She died giving childbirth to Benjamin. So, with all of this happening and going on, Jacob had prospered living with his uncle. He had gathered herds of goats and sheep, and he had become a rich man, and finally he felt like God was leading him to go back home. But he remembered that somebody was waiting for him there, Esau. And he was afraid to go home for fear that Esau would kill him. And so he does an interesting thing. You can imagine what an entourage this must have been. With these wives, all these children, all these goats, all these sheep, all this cattle, all this holdings. And so he sends everybody ahead of him. And so there's this long parade of cattle and sheep and goats and people and servants and wagons full of goods and stuff. Jacob comes at the very end of it. And when he finally gets there, Esau embraces him and kisses him. And they become friends and brothers again. Because Esau has gotten over it. And he besides he has seen how God has blessed Jacob. And so the brothers bury the hatchet, so to speak, not in one another's head, but they just bury it. Now, Esau became the founder of the country of Edom. And it became a country later on that Israel even warred with from time to time, because they were not a God-fearing tribe, not a God-fearing people, because Esau married among the Canaanite women. Okay, so that's just sort of the story here. Now next week we're going to pick up with Joseph and how all of this came to a head. And it's going to be a very interesting story. But I want to back up from this and look at this. This is several chapters of story. The writer who wrote this, and I believe it was Moses, but that's a toss-up. What do you think God wanted us to learn from this story? What lesson is in it for us that we need? You know, you look at the beginning of it and you see lies and deceit, and you see God still honor his promise in spite of that. Do you know that God doesn't take away your salvation every time you sin or tell a lie or do something wrong? No, we have security in what we believe in Christ. We know that God will never take our salvation from us or remove the Holy Spirit from us. We have what's called the eternal security of the believer. No matter what we do, we are saved and forgiven, because when Jesus died on the cross for our sins, he died for our sins past, present, and future. Now, I'm not saying that lying and deceiving and falling into sin is a good thing, certainly. But one of the things that happens when we do, the Holy Spirit begins to work on us, doesn't it? And begins to speak to our heart, you know, what you've done is wrong, or what you said is wrong, or those plans are not good plans, or this isn't what I wanted to do. And before long, we're convicted of our sin. We're convicted. We come back and we confess our sins to the Lord, and he says, you have already been forgiven by the blood of the cross. But one of the interesting things about this story is, no matter what Jacob did, no matter what he said, no matter where he went, God went out of his way to say, Jacob, I am with you. You are my chosen, and I am with you. And there is a verse in the 13th chapter. In the last part of the 13th chapter of Hebrews, verse 5, where God says, I will never leave you nor forsake you. Now, you know, that's quite a promise, folks. No matter where you find yourself today, whether you are in God's will, not in God's will, doing things God's way, not doing God's way, if you are a believer and you've given your heart to Jesus, God will never leave you or forsake you. And I want to tell you something, folks. I'm like everybody else. I've been down the road. And I've done some things I'm not proud of, pleased with, or anything I necessarily want to share. But the point of the matter is, in my heart, I've always known that God will not leave me nor forsake me. And it's that promise from God always brought me back to say, God, I'm so sorry I went astray. I'm so sorry I sinned. Oh God, I know I'm forgiven, but I confess to you my sin. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for your forgiveness. Thank you for your patience with me. That's our prayer every day, folks. That's how Christians pray. Lord God, thank you for your grace. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for your forgiveness. Thank you for your patience with me. I know you'll never give up on me. Would you stand, please? Every head bowed and every eye closed for just a moment. While we bow before the Lord, if there's someone here today that needs prayer, that's maybe struggling with a situation or looking to make a decision, or needing to know what God would have them do, maybe you've fallen into sin, maybe you've allowed yourself to creep into some areas that you don't belong, or maybe needs to be resolved, that you need to get right before God. While every head is bowed and eyes are closed, would you simply slip your hand aside?